party last night?
I was in Reno. They gave me an award.
Yeah, I know, I heard that.
Hello, hi. How are you? I'm Frankie. Nice to meet you. Was Nanga copy? I have the printed copy. Let me just grab them.
Yes. Yes.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Hey, Governor.
Happy day. How are you?
Yes. Born in elementary school.
Big boy, remember you like that?
Yeah.
In the same bus to Capitol Hill.
Yeah. Nice to see you. Congratulations.
Thank you. Rick, pleasure to meet you.
This
home.
The Committee on Natural Resources will come to order. I'd like to welcome everyone to the Hilton Hotel here in the heart of Guam for this timely hearing on the importance of the U.S. Pacific territories and the freely associated states to the United States' ability to counter the PRC's malign influence and maintain our nation's strategic interest in the region. Before we begin our official business, we'll begin by begin the hearing with the U.S. National Anthem sung by Master Sergeant Jack Leramer from Joint Region Marianas. Sergeant, let's all stand and we'll do the national anthem.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof to the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet waved o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
If you'll remain standing, we will now do the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. You may be seated. Thank you, Sergeant, for singing the national anthem, and thank you to everyone for being here today. Without objection, the chair is authorized to declare recess of the committee at any time. This committee is meeting today to hear testimony on peace through strength, the strategic importance of the Pacific Islands to U.S.-led global security. Under Committee Rule 4F, any oral opening statements at hearings are limited to the chairman and the ranking minority member. I therefore ask unanimous consent that all other members' opening statements be made part of the hearing record if they are submitted in accordance with Committee Rule 3O. Without objection, so ordered. I would also want to make everybody on the panel, the members and the witnesses, aware that there's a three-second delay, I'm told, with the microphone. So when you push the button, give a few moments to let the system get queued up before you begin speaking. I will now recognize myself for an opening statement. Half a day and good morning. It's again a pleasure to be here. Thank you, Governor, for hosting us in Guam. Today, the House Committee on Natural Resources has the great privilege of convening this hearing on this beautiful island of Guam in the heart of the Pacific. I would like to thank the people of Guam for the hospitality that you've exhibited to our entire congressional delegation. It's truly an honor to be with you here today and to be joined by so many of my colleagues. The warm reception we have received reflects the beauty of this island and its people. I also want to thank members of Guam's local government who are with us or who are taking time to be with the delegation and meet with us while we're on the island. I would especially like to thank my friend and Congressman Jim Moreland for the invitation to visit the island and to hold this hearing, and most importantly, for his tireless work and on the Committee of Natural Resources on behalf of the people of Guam. Lastly, I'd like to acknowledge the bipartisan group of members of Congress who have joined us for this historic hearing and thank each of them for being here. There are incredible demands on our time, and our participation in the hearing demonstrates the importance and the critical nature of our discussion. We're here today at a pivotal point in our nation's history. Less than 2,000 miles away lies a threat to America and our allies. The People's Republic of China, under the tyranny of the Communist Chinese or the Chinese Communist Party, not only seeks to challenge American leadership, but is aggressively working to undermine the democratic values and institutions that we cherish. We are a freedom-loving people in America. And above all, we must never forget that it is freedom that unites us. It is freedom. And as we had some meetings earlier this morning, and I heard folks talk about the history of Guam and the way that people here cherish freedom and love freedom, and they've seen that freedom challenged in the past, that I know that it's truly an American thing that we, above all else, put freedom first, and we're willing to make sacrifices, and there have been many sacrifices made in the past to protect that freedom. And I have no doubt that as we move forward, we will make the necessary, take the necessary steps and make the necessary sacrifices so that people can love and enjoy freedom. And it's important to explain that when we refer to the PRC, we are referring to China's ruling Communist Party. There is a distinct difference between the PRC's leadership and the many Chinese citizens who long for that same freedom that we as Americans enjoy. The recent PRC state-sponsored hacking campaigns in Guam targeted critical U.S. infrastructure systems and demonstrate that Guam is not only a target for Chinese aggression, but is also on the front lines of the fight against this threat. Beijing is fully aware of the strategic importance of Guam to the U.S., and it's testing boundaries by simulating attacks on the island. Guam's importance to our nation's history cannot be overstated, and it's bravely faced foreign threats before. The tragedy and sacrifice made by the people of this island in World War II is not forgotten, as Guam celebrated Liberation Day last month. Our fight today is to preserve freedom across the U.S. territories and for all U.S. allies in the Pacific. Like the Empire of Japan once did, the PRC aims to dominate the Pacific and island people. While modern threats may look slightly different and include political and informational warfare, the underlying motives of domination and aggression remain. The PRC continues its nefarious activities by using its resources to exert influence in the U.S. territories and the freely associated states. The U.S. will swiftly address and counter the PRC's maligned activity in the Pacific region. Congress has a responsibility to meet this challenge head-on and to protect our shared American interest. It is for this very reason that the members of this congressional delegation are here today. This hearing will spotlight the PRC's maligned activity in the U.S. territories and the freely associated states and examine how the U.S. will stand united against these threats, both on the continental part of our country and our partners in the Pacific. Again, I want to thank the witnesses for their participation in this important hearing, and I look forward to your testimony. I yield back my time, and I now recognize the ranking member of the committee, or acting ranking member of the committee today, Ms. Ledger Fernandez from the great state of New Mexico.
Thank you so very much, Dave.
Okay. Go ahead.
3 seconds. Thank you so very much, Mr. Chairman. And I truly want to thank each of our witnesses who've come here today, because it is the role of Congress to truly listen. Because if we do not listen to the voices that come from the people of America, from the people who are experts, because you live this reality on these islands with the threat of China ever so close. And it is our job to listen to those so that we can then take your voices back to the People's House and determine a policy that is in many ways written by you and your concerns. And so I'm very grateful to the chairman for pulling this bipartisan visit together to the region. I'm very grateful in advance to what we have already learned on this visit, both about military issues, but also about what it means to be one Guam, what it means to be American in this island and in this great, beautiful Pacific. And we know that we must not say the U.S. as of though it is something over here, but when we are talking about the territories that are part of the U.S., it is us the United States, that there is no us and them in this region. It is an us. And so I'm very thankful for that. The witnesses are so impressive. Governor Guerrero, Governor Palacios, Governor Mauga, and I hope I said that right, as well as to Minister Oding and Udi Jr. and the Acting Secretary Cantero. So it is actually my first visit to Guam, which it might be some of the others. I come from a state that is in the middle of the country. It has no island, it has no water around it. So whenever I see this much water, I get so very happy. And we recognize the decades, the four decades that the United States has maintained a special relationship with the freely associated states, the Federated States of Micronesia, and the Republic of the Marshall Islands, as well as the Republic of Palau. And the compacts of free association, as we've been listening to them in this committee over the last many months, recognize the importance of continuing that relationship into the future. And as my colleagues have said, I do not think that there is any doubt that all of us don't recognize that importance. We are unified in a bipartisan manner across these issues, and our need in this visit to once again listen to you tell us of why it is so important, so we can then go back and convince our colleagues. And I don't think they'll need that much convincing. I think you all have done a good job, and history has done the job of telling us why this is important and why this region is in this moment as important as it is. The Biden administration and the presidential envoy for COFA negotiations, Ambassador Joseph Yun, are really be commended for securing these new compact agreements with FSM and Palau in May. And while negotiations have not been completely concluded with the RMI, we expect that they will be soon. Approving the proposal to review the financial provisions of the Compact of Free Association with FSM, Palau, and the MRI will continue our engagement with the FAAs and diminish the risk of China filling the vacuum in the region. We have heard when you have said that our people are scared of China, because these are smaller islands, and these are places where the threat could be easily carried out. And so we will continue that, and we will continue to make sure that this point of the spear, as it's been pointed out, continues to be strong and aimed accurately. Inclusion, I want to once again thank you, Mr. Chairman, for scheduling this hearing today. I want to thank the panelists for pointing out that it's not just the military link, but it is also the link that will honor the sacred that it is, the waters, the sea, and all those beautiful creatures of earth and of God that we have been given to protect those, to protect the environment, even as we protect the people and the security of each of the islands and of the United States. Muchísimas gracias. Thank you so very much, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you, Representative Ledger Fernandez. I'll now introduce our witnesses. On our first panel, we'll be having two panels today, and first off, someone who obviously needs no introduction here, but the Honorable Lourdes Lou Leon Guerrero, Governor of Guam from Hagatna, Guam. The Honorable Arnold I. Palacios, Governor of the Commonwealth of Northern Mariana Islands from Saipan, Mariana Islands. The Honorable Caleb Udui, Jr., Minister of Finance, Republic. The Honorable Caleb Udui, Jr., Minister of Finance, Republic of Parau, Kurur Palau. The Honorable Ricky Quintero, Acting Secretary, Department of Foreign Affairs, Federated States of Micronesia of Pohnpei, Federated States of Micronesia. The Honorable Jack Adding, Minister of Foreign Affairs and Trade, Republic of the Marshall Islands, Majuru, Republic of Marshall Islands. Now, let me remind the witnesses that under committee rules, they must limit their oral statements to 5 minutes, but their entire statement will appear in the hearing record. To begin your testimony, please press the on button. Remember, there is a 3-second delay, and we do use timing lights. When you begin, the light will turn green. At the end of 5 minutes, the light will turn red, and I'll ask you to please complete your statement. I'll also allow witnesses on the panel to testify before member questioning. The chair now recognizes Governor Guerrero for 5 minutes.
Chairman Westerman, Ranking Member Congresswoman Fernandez, and members of the House Committee on Natural Resources, Hafaday, welcome to Guam, and thank you for flying so far to meet us here. I want to emphasize the vital importance of Guam and other Pacific Islands in U.S.-led global security. Throughout history, Guam has played a crucial role due to its strategic location, sitting at the crossroads of Pacific powers. With its protected harbor and comparatively large landmass, Guam serves as a critical hub for air and sea travel connecting China, Southeast Asia, Japan, and North America. This positioning has made Guam pivotal in major American conflicts, contributing to peace and shared prosperity in the Pacific. However, in recent times, China's increasing influence in the region has raised serious, threatening, and real concerns. China's efforts to expand its reach to other Pacific Island countries through infrastructure projects, political maneuvering, and socioeconomic coercion have repercussions for the Pacific Islands, including Guam. China's intentions indicate a potential threat to regional stability. An attempt to exert control over the region concealed in otherwise benign diplomatic agreements. Security in the Pacific means a viable and robust economy. Security in the Pacific means an educated workforce, a quality healthcare system, reliable infrastructure, resiliency of a community, and digital modernization. Security in the Pacific and the stable trade with Asia that follows, it resonates far beyond the Pacific. Nearly 95% of America's potential customers live outside U.S. borders. 29% of U.S. exports of goods are sent to Asia. And this region represents over $2 trillion in trade in goods with the United States in 2022. Moreover, the supply chain that sustains our daily lives from food to electronics rely on a secure Pacific. Given these circumstances, the question before us is simple. Who should shape the rules of future trade in the Indo-Pacific? If the U.S. does not engage actively, China will. Writing a future that will never put Americans first. To prevent this, I support bipartisan efforts to enhance U.S. engagement in the region and support efforts to bolster the security of Guam, other key territories, and our allies and partners in the Indo-Pacific. This ensures the ability to drive prosperity in a free and open Indo-Pacific, especially for developing democracies in the Pacific. I also urge the committee to create policies that allow Pacific Island countries to tap into American innovation and entrepreneurship to address perennial challenges. Furthermore, I ask Congress to recognize that our actions in the Pacific reflect the values we share: peace, prosperity, and a free democracy. I thank the Senate for including Guam in RECA legislation, and I ask the House for their support. By ensuring fair treatment of COFA citizens and investing in Guam's infrastructure and workforce development, the U.S. demonstrates its commitment to collaboration. Initiatives like a Guam-only visa program, COFA cost reimbursement, H-2B visa program, and funding for a new hospital showcase America as a reliable partner capable of cooperation and competition. In closing, I thank you, Chairman Westerman, and this committee for the opportunity to address this crucial issue. Let us work together to preserve peace, win prosperity, and expand opportunity in the Indo-Pacific region. Sijulis Masi.
Thank you, Governor Guerrero. And we'll now move on to our next witness. I want to recognize Governor Palacios for 5 minutes. You're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Hafade, Tiro Faisho, Chairman Westerman, distinguished members of the House Committee on Natural Resources, and to my fellow islanders in the committee, Congressman Sablon, Congressman Moreland, and Congresswoman Radowagan. Welcome back. Welcome back to the Marianas. Thank you for inviting me to speak with you today about some of the critical issues that are impacting our regions. Today's hearing is a testament to the significance and urgency of the role of the Pacific Islands in global geopolitics, that you have traveled thousands of miles to conduct this oversight hearing indicate that you indeed recognize the strategic value of the Pacific Islands in securing peace and freedom in our nation and the world. It is in the interest of national and global security for the United States government to protect and fortify Pacific territories and allies in the freely associated states against the growing threat of Chinese Communist Party. America's security architecture in the Pacific is not only founded in military defense, but also in the pillars of economic, social, and political stability in the region. It is based upon the economic prosperity, the health of people and ecosystem, and the rule of law. It is rooted in genuine, trustworthy relationships and shared commitments backed by actions to a free and open Indo-Pacific. As such, I am happy that the United States is at last close to completing the negotiation to renew all the Compact of Free Association Agreement. The U.S. territories of the Northern Marianas, Guam, and American Samoa firmly anchors America's position in the Pacific, and together with the freely associated states, create a vast corridor of peace and security that spans nearly 3 million square miles and connects to the seas of the other island nation. Recognizing the strategic importance of America's territories and allies in Micronesia, the CCP moves aggressively to fill perceived voids in American assistance and to capitalize on social and economic vulnerabilities of the Pacific Island communities. We see this aggression in massive investment in infrastructure and economic development. We see it in land grabs and fisheries expansion. We see it in unauthorized research vessels lurking around our undersea fiber optic cables. We see it in organized crimes, public corruption, and political interference. There is a strategic edge in all CCP's activities, and it destabilizes the island communities and cuts against America's influence and security in the region. In the Northern Marianas, during times of economic hardships and vulnerability, we too have turned to Chinese investment for solutions. In fact, for almost 40 years now, the People's Republic of China have had a firm foothold in our islands. Chinese investors were always conveniently there when we needed them, offering new industries and revenue sources that directly or indirectly advance the interests of the PRC in the Marianas. From 1980s to early 2000, we had a garment industry primarily Chinese owned, with more than 30 factories in the island of Saipan. Of course, there were many human rights and labor violations associated with the industry during those years. When the garment industry shut down, the Commonwealth lost a major source of revenue, and drastic austerity measures had a deeply destabilizing effect on our islands. To make up for the loss, we turned to Chinese tourism and also to Chinese casino gaming. Prior to COVID-19 pandemic, tourists from PRC comprised approximately 40% of all visitors arriving in the Marianas. The casino in Saipan had peaked billions of dollars in rolling chips, volumes generated in just 16 VIP tables. So for a brief period, Chinese tourism and gambling revenue propped up the Commonwealth government and the economy. But this was short-lived and had unfortunate consequences. Today, Chinese tourism dried up and the casino was shut down. The Commonwealth economy continues to struggle, and the government and our people are in deep fiscal distress. These are conditions that makes the Commonwealth, again, acutely vulnerable to CCP exploitation. Shortly after I was inaugurated as governor this year, I announced the position of my administration that we would pivot away from the Commonwealth's over-reliance on Chinese investment and seek to strengthen our relationship with federal partners and allies in the region. I worried about the instability of the Chinese markets in light of the shifting geopolitical currents. I also worried about the Commonwealth's potential exposure to national security concerns. Of course, not everyone was pleased with this position. We are taking a lot of hits for it, both economically and politically. And to this day, we are continually asked to open up to Chinese investment once again. That same kind of pressure ripples across the Pacific in various ways. Whatever form this pressure takes, it is always erosive to America's influence and security in the region. To strengthen the security architecture in the Pacific and to bolster our defense against CCP threats, the United States must expand its engagement with all of the island jurisdictions and increase support for economic and sustainable social development for our communities. I offer the following recommendation. I ask that Congress revisit the provision of the covenant between the United States and the Northern Mariana, especially our Section 702, which provides direct financial and other assistance for the Commonwealth government and the islands for government operations, capital improvements, and economic development. Secondly, we are currently facing a workforce shortage that threatens the CNMI's economic recovery. And while we fully appreciate federal government's considerable financial assistance for infrastructure improvements, we will not be able to carry these projects in a timely manner. Because of the labor challenges we face. I therefore ask for your urgent congressional support for legislation to repeal or at least delay the implementation of the touchback provision for the Commonwealth-only transitional program, which would require a significant portion of our workforce to exit the Commonwealth for an indefinite period while they wait for new permits to be processed. The touchback provision, as many of you know, probably all of you know, is to go into effect next month and could not come at the worst time for us. Many businesses in the CNMI will be adversely impacted, and therefore our economy too. Relative to this, I ask your support for Congressman Sablon's HR 560, the Population Stabilization Act, which aims to shore up the eroding population and workforce in the Northern Marianas.
Governor, I'm going to interrupt. We're going to ask you to wrap up your testimony.
Thank you.
And I'll remind the witnesses that your written testimony is part of the record, but try to keep your oral statements to 5 minutes. And if you want to just quickly wrap up, I'll afford you that.
Thank you. I've emphasized many of these points before in the testimonies in the U.S. Senate Committee on Energy and Natural Resources and before the IGIA in February and in conversation that I have with my military and political leaders. The stability of America's territories and allies in Micronesia are inseparable from national security and peace in the region. Help us help ourselves so we can be stronger partners in bolstering national security and ensuring that the Pacific remains a haven of peace, prosperity, and freedom. Thank you, Jesus Masi Yiliso, for inviting me to testify before you today, and for coming all this way to have this field here. May God bless the Northern Marianas, all of the Pacific Islands, and may God bless America.
Thank you, Governor. I'll now recognize Minister the Dewey Jr. For 5 minutes of testimony. You're recognized.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, distinguished members, it's an honor to be here. Ali from Palau. President Whips would be here, as he was in the committee's task force hearing last month, but he has a long-standing commitment to host more than 20 members of the national legislatures of Japan and Taiwan today. So he has approved my statement submitted in writing, and he looks forward to meeting with you in Palau. The Compact of Free Association between our nations is somewhat unique. It provides the United States can use any land it needs for defense. This is why a top U.S. military commander has called Palau part of the homeland. We are the westernmost jurisdiction in which the U.S. has exclusive strategic rights. Our land, sea, and airspace, the size of Texas, borders Asia and includes shipping lanes critical to China. It is also where Chinese vessels have been without authorization. The U.S. is now putting its closest to Asia earliest warning radars and extending a runway in Palau. It is also considering other facilities. There appears to have been a Chinese effort to derail one of the radars through a proposal to locate a hotel and casino next door. That proposal was not only more attractive to the local community, but it played to fears that U.S. military facilities will make Palau a target, as it was in World War II. President Whips and I want Palau and the U.S. to be inextricably linked and Palau to continue to stand firmly with Taiwan. Continuation, however, cannot be taken for granted. China has worked to undermine our relationship and has made inroads. Another unique aspect of our compact is that it requires periodic joint reviews of the relationship and Palau's needs with a U.S. commitment to act on the conclusions. The first review agreement in 2010, however, was not approved by Congress for 8 years, only because of a dispute between the U.S. executive and Congress on how to pay for it. China took advantage of the impasse. It began to subject Palau to economic carrots and sticks to shift our alliances. Tourism is our largest industry. During the U.S. impasse, China quickly ramped up tourist visits from a handful to two-thirds of the 160,000 tourists a year. It bought hotel rooms far in advance, crowding out visitors from other nations. Then it said it would cut off the flow if we didn't shift. We didn't shift, and it did cut off those flows. COVID hit right after. The two blows shrank our economy 30% in just 5 years, causing real pain for our people and eliminating budget surpluses. China has offered to send us many tourists as we can accommodate and establish a huge new industry in Palau, but again, only if we shift alliances. Tourism from other nations is coming back, but slowly. We are working to develop these markets and get more flights, but are limited by a runway so short that only smaller jets can use it, larger ones at a maximum of 70% passenger loads. We are also working to develop other industries. Meanwhile, most private sector investment in Palau is from China. Some of our people, including some of our most important leaders, are tempted by its offers. They see China as the best opportunity for the private sector growth that we want. The U.S. does not have a command economy, but it has the compact and the agreement produced by the second review. Enacting the legislation for it by the agreed date of September 30, or as soon as possible this year, is the most effective way to counter China and maintain U.S. strategic interests. The agreement has already been approved by Palau's Congress. After the experience of the 2010 agreement, a significant delay in the new agreement will give those in Palau who see a future with China or who have Chinese connections an opportunity to sow doubt about the U.S. A long enough delay would be another opportunity for China to affect our economy and our people. Thank you for the opportunity to speak today.
Thank you to the gentleman for your testimony. I now recognize Acting Secretary Quintero for 5 minutes. You're recognized for your testimony.
Thank you. Chairman Westerman, Ranking Member Teresa Ledger Fernandez, members of the House Natural Resources Committee, thank you for convening this hearing today and for the opportunity to testify before you this morning. My name is Ricky Francisco Cantero. I am the FSM's Acting Secretary of Foreign Affairs. I have had the distinct honor to serve my country in its foreign service for the last 24 years. On behalf of President Simina, I have the honor to share my government's perspectives on the long-standing U.S. FSM partnership, including ways to strengthen our collaboration. I begin by confirming the FSM's firm commitment to fulfill all of its compact obligations, including those related to security and defense. The FSM, of course, follows closely the changing dynamics of competition in the Indo-Pacific region. The FSM is committed to doing its part to cooperate with the United States to ensure that our region, our people, live in a safe and secure environment, as enshrined in our compact. The security and defense interests of the United States are the security and defense interests of the FSM. The ever-increasing enlistment of our citizens to serve in the U.S. Armed Forces and those that have paid the ultimate sacrifice is leaving testimony to this creed. Our relationship with the United States predates the establishment of the FSM as a sovereign country and dates back to the period immediately following the Second World War. When we became a sovereign country in 1986, we gave the U.S. strategic rights of denial over a vast portion of the Western Pacific Ocean, with the U.S. retaining responsibility for the security and defense of the FSM. This arrangement continues. This responsibility includes the right to foreclose military access of other countries, to defend the FSM and its people from military threats, and the right to establish and use military areas and facilities in the FSM on agreed terms. These steps all provide the U.S. with the access to our sovereign territory to protect shared security interests in the region. The security and defense elements of the compact has no termination date. The FSM is committed to playing a vital role in supporting the U.S. security presence in the Pacific and the United States' effort to combat foreign aggression in the region. Through our prescribed Joint Committee meeting, for example, the FSM continues to work with the U.S. military in identifying ways of strengthening and enriching bilateral security engagements under the compact. The FSM conducts its own foreign policy in foreign relations in ways that are very consistent with the terms of the amended compact. The FSM maintains the U.S. as its primary partner while also having diplomatic relations with over 90 countries throughout the region and around the world. Additionally, the FSM and U.S. belong to many of the same international organizations, including the United Nations, where voting practices of the two nations are aligned and remain very, very consistent. The FSM ties with the U.S. are strong, ongoing, and permanent. Beyond Congress's consideration of the pending compact legislation to extend expiring economic assistance provisions until 2043, there are numerous other opportunities to enhance our collaboration. The FSM welcomes strengthening joint activities with the U.S. Department of Defense, which, among others, include military construction projects in the FSM. For many years, the Department of Defense deployed civic action team in the FSM to support development initiatives up on our islands. Noting that the CAT program lapsed in 2003, the FSM is pleased to see U.S. congressional efforts advocating for its restoration. Similarly, the FSM fully supports ongoing efforts that we hope will lead to restoring the U.S. Peace Corps program in the FSM, an essential program in direct support of people-to-people engagements. These kinds of initiatives are very important to strengthening and enriching our existing ties with the U.S. We look forward to working with the committee on ways to enhance our enduring partnership with the U.S. We hope the U.S. Congress approves the compact legislation expeditiously to usher in the next chapter of the enduring FSM-U.S. compact partnership. Mr. Chairman, I thank you for this opportunity to testify, and I look forward to answering questions. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Secretary Quintero. I now recognize Minister Adding for 5 minutes.
Thank you. Thank you, Chairman Westerman. Yahweh. Mr. Chairman and distinguished members, thank you for inviting President Gabua or a designee to this important hearings. It is extremely time-consuming to travel here and back from the Marshall Islands, so I am representing my president. President Gabua and his cabinet look forward to meet with you next week. Under the free association between our nations, the RMI, allows the U.S. to deny access to forces of other nations to an area west of Hawaii, as big as Alaska, California, and Florida combined. Refrain from interaction with other nations that the U.S. says would compromise security. And owes what the Joint Chief of Staff says is the world's premier range for testing ICBMs and supporting military space operation. Kwajalein is where the military perfected its missile strike to be so precise that shot can hit a single house thousands of miles away. RMI is also a staunch ally of Taiwan. During the U.S. administration of our islands, we also served U.S. strategic interests worldwide by the U.S. using our islands for most of all of its atmospheric nuclear pump tests. The U.S. perfected its nuclear weapon in our islands. It also sent radioactive waste from tests in Nevada to our islands. The detonation in our island were equivalent to 1.7 Hiroshima bomb every day for 12 years. The radioactive iodine was 42 times that in Nevada and 150 times that from Chernobyl. The U.S. Senate has just passed legislation to expand the Radiation Exposure Compensation Act to cover the health problem from the Marshall test, but only for residents of Guam. At the same time, the U.S. only recognized that 4 of our 29 atolls were affected. Before the U.S.'s biggest bomb test ever at the beginning, U.S. officials learned that winds would blow radioactive to inhabited Romulab. They went ahead anyway. 70% of the children under 10 developed thyroid tumors. Several women from Romulab and Udra gave birth to babies without spines. Other babies were stillborn or born without limbs on the adult that U.S. has not recognized they were contaminated. The people of Bikini, anywhere that where I'm from, Romulab and Uduruk, were forced to leave their islands, but resettled based on U.S. assurance it was safe, only to find out years later that no local food could be safely consumed due to high level of radiation. So some of the islands of Bikini and Enweather were favorized. Many others remain unsafe for habitations or local source today. The U.S. administers us in trust for the UN. When the Security Council expressed concern about plans to test at Enweather, President Truman wrote, and I quote, "The Enweather will be accorded all constitutional rights of the citizen under the Constitution and will be dealt with as wards for whom this country has special responsibility," end quote. The settlement for the Marshallese, many of whom have been exiled from home for most of the century, is a fraction of the billion paid to compensate Americans who live hundreds of miles from Nevada test. The sad fact is that the U.S. has fallen far short, treating us equally, fairly, and consistently with the compact. The RMI highly value our free association and want it to continue. Unresolved problems from the nuclear tests and radioactive waste is a serious irritant in our relations and has the potential for being exploited by China. The compact agreement would not solve the issue, but it would be an important step in doing so. Thank you, Imkumoldada.
Thank you, Minister Adding, and thank you to all the witnesses for your testimony. Minister Adding, I do have a large Marshallese population in my home state of Arkansas, and really enjoy getting to interact with those folks when I'm back home. That concludes our witness testimony. We're now going to move to our member questions. Each member will be recognized for 5 minutes, and we're going to start with the gentleman from Colorado. Mr. Lamborn, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
I want to thank Chairman Westerman and also the leadership of my colleague on the House Armed Services Committee, Congressman Jim Moreland. Representative Moreland is a tireless advocate for Guam in Congress. Half a day to all of the distinguished panelists and all the members of the audience, and thank you for being part of today's Natural Resources Committee oversight hearing. As some of the panelists have noted, we have traveled thousands of miles to show our support of the strategic value of the Pacific Islands in protecting U.S. interests and human rights in general and free trade in the Indo-Pacific region. As a beacon for democracy and a strategically important counter to Beijing, the U.S. needs to increase its support of our Pacific Island territories and our treaty partners. Governor Guerrero, I'm going to ask my first question to you. In your testimony, you note that the Chinese Communist Party's intent to project power onto Guam and her sister islands, and you described that very well. We've all recently become aware of the CCP's cyber attack on telecommunication systems in Guam via their Volt Typhoon actor. Can you describe any other malicious tactics that you have witnessed that the CCP has undertaken to challenge U.S. military interests in this entire region?
Thank you very much, Congressman. I have not witnessed anything, nor have I had any official reports about Chinese attacks. There has been, reports in the paper and in articles, but not anything officially written to me.
Okay.
But be that as it may, we do understand and recognize this great threat of our cybersecurity. During the typhoon, we witnessed and experienced a shutdown of communications. Our radio stations were not on. Our telecommunications were not on. We had no means of communicating with each other. That was a feeling of paralysis for me. And it was a very scary feeling because I could not even talk to my frontliners or my frontline defense people or even communicate with my family. And just think about what that means in terms of life in general. So we very much experience what I think could happen if there is a big Chinese cybersecurity attack. Can you imagine if all our airport and our port authority is paralyzed because of those attacks? We would not be able to survive. And so although we have not had a real experience of that through China's cybersecurity attack, we experienced it during the typhoon and after the typhoon. And so what we are doing as a government is we are creating a cybersecurity island-wide emergency plan. And we are working with very key stakeholders in business and public sectors. We have directed our government agencies specifically to establish their cybersecurity plan, which will filter up towards our island-wide security.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I'm going to have to ask another question before my time runs out. I appreciate that answer, though. There are so many things that we could point to that the Chinese Communist Party is doing to suppress other peoples when they don't get their way. The suppression of human rights and political rights in Hong Kong against what they had promised that they would do when the UK withdrew. Genocide against the Uyghur population in Western China. Theft of international intellectual property. Debt diplomacy. And then there's illegal fishing. What experience do any of the other witnesses here have of illegal fishing in your territorial and sovereign waters?
Thank you, Congressman Lamborn. With respect to your question, Congressman, the FSL appreciates the long-standing cooperation with U.S. on any and all illegal, unreported, and unregulated fishing in its waters. For example, the FSL appreciates the support it has received from the U.S. Coast Guard on these issues and values its cooperation with the U.S. Coast Guard in the new expanded shipwrighter program. The assistance we receive is helpful to all illegal fishing activities. In a nutshell, the support that we get from your side, especially from the U.S. Coast Guard, is very, very critical. We just went through an annual joint committee meeting with your military. We do it on an annual basis, and we review the defense strategic posturing in this region. And one of the issues that we always discuss is how do we counter illegal fishing.
Excellent.
And that's one of the primary reasons why we agreed to the expanded shipwrighter agreement.
Excellent. Thank you so much. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from the Northern Marianas, Mr. Sablon. You're recognized for 5 minutes. Mr. Sablon, is your microphone on?
No. Yeah, so I'm grateful, sir, that you've taken the time to come out here. I know it's a big chunk of your August break, but thank you very much. Welcome to our witnesses, and good morning para todos. Governor Palacios, I'm going to sort of stick with you for now, sir. You mentioned Covenant 702. We have obviously a problem with our workforce. Construction is a major issue with us, where we have like how much in projects you estimate that are not moving because of?
As of today, we have an estimated that I know of over half a $1 billion projects already approved.
Yeah, and that requires just a technical change in some of the legislation, but it is important that we get these things moving. You mentioned an issue of touchback. How many businesses are affected this year by this touchback issue?
I can assure that there's over 60%, maybe more, of our businesses, all the hotels, all the construction companies. And so all the projects are going to be impacted.
And the covenant section 702, right? It was really a wonderful section in the beginning. We even had capital improvement funds and everything. We had a little money up front for operation. What do you want Congress to do?
Consider not necessarily changing where we're at today regarding the Covenant 702, but consider putting aside another $10 to $20 million just as a set aside for operations of our government in case we run into problem again. That's where we're at today. And thankfully, there is a clause in the agreement that gives us a little bit of flexibility today.
Thank you. Governor, is this still on?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Governor, thank you very much. And some of you who know me well enough know that I have been quiet about the Northern Marianas relationship with the People's Republic of China. I've been quiet about that for a while. We had a trade with China. But I am now concerned that there have been some things that has happened here in our region. For example, not necessarily by the people of China, but of course the government, CCP and PLA. And concerned enough that I've actually taken a stand and said, look, I will join this task force and work with trying to get also our Micronesian brothers and sisters fairly treated and agreed to. Thank you to ministers, Mr. Secretary, Mr. Adding. It's nice to see you again, sir. Governor Guerrero. Mr. Odui, you have anything more to add? I think I have time, right? No, I don't.
You've got time.
Oh, yeah. Mr. Minister, you have anything you'd like to say? Don't worry. These people know, sir, that we are family. And that as family, you and I are allowed to talk about them behind their back.
Not to say that I would do that, but yeah. Thank you for the opportunity to add. I think the realities are evident when you're able to visit our islands yourself and see firsthand what exactly we're dealing with. So to Congressman Lamborn's question on fishing, you know, Palau has closed off our waters to commercial fishing because it's just too impossible to regulate. And we appreciate the U.S.'s help helping patrol our waters, and to counter intrusions, these unauthorized access that survey our undersea fiber optic cables. But the other point is, Congressman Sablan, that this is not something that happens periodically. It happens every day, and it happens at different levels. We have a federal system. It happens at the state levels and with our state legislatures as well as our state executive officials are approached almost every day. So it is something that we have to be mindful of and address as part of the routine order of business every day. Thank you.
No, thank you. My time is over, Mr. Chairman.
Gentlemen's time has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentlelady from American Samoa, Ms. Radawagan. You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Talofa. Let me first thank my chairman, Mr. Westerman, for appointing me to serve as chair of the House Natural Resources Committee's bipartisan task force on the Indo-Pacific. Thanks also to Chairwoman Hageman. As a prelude to today's proceedings, we conducted a task force hearing in July on PRC, COFA, and the territories with the valued support and leadership of task force co-chair Kilili Sablan. This hearing truly is a homecoming for me, having lived here and graduated from the University of Guam, but this hearing is also about the Marshall Islands, where my family lived for years when my father was appointed head of government under the administration of President Eisenhower and Interior Secretary Seaton in the darkest days of the Cold War. And at that time, the shadowy world of creeping communism, totalitarianism, was nightmarishly illuminated by ominously frightful over-the-horizon flashes emanating from 67 nuclear weapon tests in the Marshalls. Nuclear testing ended shortly before my father was sent to take the first steps to restore a post-nuclear testing civil order, which literally included his own footsteps across atomic bomb craters on his inspection at Bikini and Eniwetok. And we meet here in the southernmost of the Mariana Islands to hear from the governor of the northernmost of the Mariana Islands, where my family lived for 12 years, while my father represented President Kennedy and Secretary of the Interior Udall in relations with the Northern Marianas, Marshall Islands, Palau, Yap, Pohnpei, Chuuk, and Koh Samui. So I join this homecoming with my father's spirit close in my heart and in my mind, aware that much of it was in the Cold War era under the UN trusteeship. Guam and the CNMI formed the westernmost of America's homeland at the doorstep of Asia in the time zone adjacent to Tokyo's. We are here as a committee because Guam and CNMI truly are the northern keystones in the architecture of the what since 1945 has been mostly a free and open Pacific. In this new era, America's allies in Palau, FSM, and RMI form the integrated superstructure of regional security and peace. Once as a child, mentored by my father and other leaders of the Pacific nations who so often sat at our dinner table, and now as an elected leader in this region, I understand in a very profound way how and why the UN trusteeship, our compact of free association, stood for decades against Soviet imperialism as a threat to democracy and post-colonial free enterprise under rule of law. Now we're facing the threat of the once concealed but now overt velvet-gloved hand of PRC ambitions that hides the iron fist of PRC totalitarian communist imperialism. Thus, we come here under Chairman Westerman's leadership to regroup and confront together the PRC's threat to the freedom of the Blue Continent that stretches across the Indo-Pacific region. Of course, the American homeland also reaches deep into the Southern Pacific, where American Samoa's alignment with the U.S. is foundational to a free and open regional order. And I have the honor of serving first and foremost my own people in my family's true homeland, where my father was elected and served with both great dedication and success as governor. So it's in that spirit of homecoming that I want to commend each of my fellow Pacific Islanders who are witnesses today. In addition to your oral testimony, I urge my colleagues to study your written statements for the record. We gather here in the Pacific Way, but you have spoken your truth here today boldly. In that same spirit, my question to each witness is based on the powerful statement written by the governor of the CNMI that exposes PRC methods and tactics to opportunistically exploit our needs and weaknesses. Let me say that when I run out of time, and I'm about to, I'm going to ask each of these witnesses to please submit this, the answers for the record, please. We can learn from Governor Palacios how PRC uses illegal influence in a democracy to corrupt and destroy democracy. PRC invests in free enterprise with political warfare instead of profit motives to destroy free enterprise. Without naming names or specific economic sectors or institutions that are under attack, please tell us if you are aware of PRC political warfare tactics going on today in your islands. Is it getting worse year by year? Are your governments becoming more effective in restoring the rule of law? And finally, again, without revealing specific cases, is U.S. law enforcement and U.S. Department of Justice cooperating in any criminal investigations you are pursuing? Now I have 35 seconds. Perhaps one witness could answer and the other submit it for the record. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Congresswoman. Yes, we will do that. I will further submit also a written response to your questions. Yes, we see it. We absolutely see it. with the geopolitical sands shifting in the Indo-Pacific region, we saw what was going on. So luckily, when the pandemic closed down our economy and all the flights coming into the Northern Marianas, that was sort of a blessing because we have almost half of our tourism industry, our visitors were coming in for PRC. Over 200,000 tourists in 2019. That's significant.
Thank you, Governor. And I'll look forward to getting the rest of your written answers in the near future. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you, Representative Radewagen, and thank you for your leadership on the task force and for your obviously vast knowledge of the region. It's a real benefit to have you serving on the committee. I now recognize the gentleman from Wisconsin, Mr. Tiffany. You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Cantero, in March of this year, President Pinello wrote a letter stating how the CCP is waging political warfare in the Federated States. How is the situation? And by the way, it was a very methodical, detailed letter that the president wrote, and I hope you've had a chance to read it, all of you, because I've read it twice. Very methodical, very detailed, and have things changed since that letter, Mr. Cantero?
Thank you, Congressman Tiffany, for your question. I think the great thing about that letter is that it provides some highlights. Highlights that the FSM.
Mr. Cantero, can you pull the microphone a little closer?
I was saying, I think the great thing about that letter is that it provided some highlights. It provided some allegations of challenges. It provided some inputs to the FSM government, and particularly the current administration, things that we can take on and see how we can improve. At the same time, I have every confidence that our internal good governance process is more than suitable to weed out if there is something is happening and identify those and provide some rectification to it.
So the FSM government has duly noted the letter and is aware that we need to be cautious in dealing with the PRC.
We are fully aware of the content of the letter. And like I was saying, the highlights provided will give us the impetus to make things better for us.
Thank you. Governor Palacios, does birth tourism continue in the CNMI?
Not to the extent that it was 4 or 5 years ago. Very recently, I was alerted by our Commonwealth Healthcare Corporation, our hospital, that there's a little tick, just a marginal tick. And I ask that they continue to monitor that. Right now, we don't have any direct flights in from China. We have direct flights. Chinese tourists were coming in through Korea. We go from Hong Kong or other points, go to Korea, but the number of tourists now coming to Saipan is almost dwindled to nothing, so over 1,000 in the last month. So the populations or the number of tourists that are coming in, at this point, no, that's not a major point of concern for us. We will be continuing to monitor that, and we will.
Is it your government's actions that have limited that number compared to what it was a few years ago?
Well, it was. It was, and we had asked all our tour groups, charter flights, to continue to monitor it with our CBP.
Thank you for doing that. And Mr. Chairman, I just highlight, this is one of the many loopholes in our immigration system that is not solving our workforce challenge. We hear about the workforce challenges. And while we have millions of people coming into the mainland of America, the lower 48 states, we have so many loopholes that, like this, that are allowing illegal immigration to fester in our country. And it still remains a major challenge because it is not solving the workforce challenge, how we're handling it currently in America. Mr. Uday, I just have, if you could take just a couple seconds, what happens if Palau succumbs to this dollar diplomacy that's been going on with the PRC? Or is your country, or is Palau making sure that you don't?
The committee will stand in recess. I'll remind the audience that this is an official hearing of the United States Congress. We are following the rules of the House. We ask that you respect the proceedings of the committee hearing.
Can I have a few seconds back, Mr. Chairman?
We're currently in recess, but I will give you your time back. Okay, the committee will come to order, and the gentleman is recognized to finish your question.
Let me restate my question. Have you seen any instances of the PRC trying to bribe government officials?
Thank you, Congressman. And I think the I would say that there are clear influences towards our government officials in the form of trips or invitations for trips, or sponsored trips to Beijing, for instance, and to dinners, and some of these even in-country, where we later found out the connections to organized crime or to the CCP. With the help of U.S. officials to identify these individuals. So I think it's as I said, a daily affair, and some of it we can see, some of it we try to stop, and we appreciate the U.S. assistance, law enforcement assistance, to help us address those challenges.
Mr. Chairman, may I make a brief close here?
You're recognized.
Yeah, thank you. First of all, this is terrific. We've been doing these hearings since this Congress convened back in January across America, and it is such a privilege to be here in the island of Guam to do this also, because this is the exact response that the House of Representatives committees has been getting across America, where we have packed houses that people attend, where they can address us rather than having to go to Washington, D.C. I want to thank all of you who are supporting Taiwan. Thank you so much for that, and it is time to end our One China policy, the misguided One China policy that was put in place in 1979. And Mr. Chairman, to that end, if you look at a map that is in our handout today from the Congressional Research Service, it lists Taiwan, or the map depicts Taiwan as being part of Communist China. That is not the case. Taiwan is a separate country. It has never been held by the mainland, and it's time for us to do our part in Congress to also recognize Taiwan as we go forward. And I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Now recognizes the gentlelady from New Mexico, Ms. Stansberry. You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and good morning. I want to just start by saying thank you to our governors and to our ministers, and I know we have many distinguished guests who are here in the audience with us. Hafa Day, thank you so much for hosting us in Guam and in the islands. And I also want to extend my thanks to our three island representatives who are representing Samoa, the Marianas Islands, and Guam with us, and who have helped to bring us here today. I am Melanie Stansberry, and I am the Congresswoman for New Mexico's 1st Congressional District. And New Mexico has many, many ties to Guam and to our islands, and especially through the service of our military. And I do want to just take a moment, because I know many, many members of our island communities have been active duty military and veterans who've served in the U.S. military, and I want to say thank you for your service and thank you for your commitment. Mr. Chairman, I'm especially grateful for this opportunity to be here. I think we've heard a lot this morning about the strategic importance of our relationships with our territories and our freely associated states. But I think, you know, some of the conversation this morning has also pointed to not only the strategic and military importance for the United States, but also because our territories are Americans, and our relationships with our sovereign nation states are also important to us because we care about the well-being of the people of the islands and all island communities. And so our commitment here is not only military and diplomatic, but also the common well-being of our communities and our commitment to the island people of the South Pacific. So I wanted to make sure that we said that. New Mexico's interest in these issues may seem a little off the beaten track, But my district is the district where Kirtland Air Force Base and Sandia National Labs reside, which play a critical role in helping to support our military missions here in the South Pacific, along with many of our bases and our national laboratories. And so we not only have a relationship with our cultural ties and our military ties, but also indirectly being engaged in the South Pacific here in these communities. And we have a shared commitment to the safety and well-being of our service members and of our communities. And that's why I myself, and I know Madam Ranking Member, who's also here from New Mexico, part of why we wanted to be here is to affirm to you all our commitment to getting these compacts to our freely associated states renewed, authorized by Congress, and making sure that we appropriate the dollars that have been committed to by the Biden administration through those negotiations that have been held with your nations. And we're here to make that commitment to you and to fight in Congress to make sure that we get those through the process. And I think it's really important to affirm that here in this forum. But I do want to take a few moments to hear, you know, Governor Guerrero, we had a moment before we came here to this hearing to talk about the threats that Chinese influence in the region play. And I was particularly struck by some of the comments that you made about the threats to freedom, democracy, and ways of life. And I wonder if you could share a little bit more about that, especially for the public, about why it's so important that we affirm American commitments here in the South Pacific.
Thank you very much. Just briefly, our history as a Guam has been an experience of war. Dates back to the 1600s when Magellan came and invaded and occupied our island, and as a result, we saw a decrease in our race from 150,000 to 8,000. But as a resilient community, we became resilient once again. We saw the Japanese occupation. So our people have witnessed and experienced direct atrocities of war, and as a result of that, we do not want to go back in that direction. We saw the atrocities of our women being raped, our children forced into labor. We had to witness beheading of our loved ones, and that is very traumatic and very, I think, significant in terms of our great desire to once again be prepared to defend our island and our people. And that's why I think our island is very much committed to working with our partners, our federal partners, our military partners, because we do not want that to happen. And as I have always said, you know, we do not want to be under Chinese rule, which can possibly happen if we do not pay attention to this part of our island and if the United States does not give us the resources and the protection to not just protect our island, but this part of the Indo-Pacific region.
Thank you, Governor. And I just want to say once again, thank you for all of you traveling here, for your commitment and your relationship to the United States. And I am unfortunately out of time, but I do want to reconfirm that we are here to fight for and make sure that we make good on our commitments. Thank you.
Gentlelady yields back. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Guam. Mr. Moreland, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you to the panel. Appreciate your time and effort coming on explaining to us, and thank you to my colleagues for being here with us today and also our audience. My questions are directed to Governor Leon Guerrero. Last fall, you began an important process of seeking membership in the Pacific Island Forum for Guam. Can you speak on how Guam's membership in the Pacific Islands Development Forum would strengthen democracy in the Pacific, please?
Thank you very much. Congressman, for that question. You know, in this part of the world, Guam is part of the North Pacific, but we are also part of the whole Pacific. And as you realize, the Pacific Islands Forum is a very strong, formidable voice that represents the concerns and the challenges and the initiatives that we as an island community move forward together. Our membership into the Pacific Island Forum is going to be very beneficial for both the islands and also from a democracy and freedom standpoint. We have been applying for associate membership, and the PIF delegation has been out here. We have spoken to them, and they are very impressed with what they feel will be a strong input to the other islands. We could contribute ideas and initiatives, innovation, creative ways of, say, dealing with how to be a stronger economy, how to educate people, how to keep our workforce developed, how to address challenges and barriers of climates that we see in the islands. Also, how we can all work together to have digital modernization throughout, because it's very key to communicate. So my passion in being a member of that is to be a member of that, to be part of this whole Pacific Island nations, and to be able to contribute to the betterment of all of our Pacific Island brothers and sisters, and so we can learn from them, too, what their challenge is, so we can, again, deliberate, discuss, debate ideas in a very official capacity.
Thank you, Governor. My next question, we both work to alleviate the housing shortage that affects the people of our island. Between the military buildup and the influx of COFA migrants, demand would only increase further, squeezing our residents. For the benefit of the committee, could you share some of the solutions you have been working on to address the housing shortages?
Yes, thank you very much. We have been working very closely with, of course, our realtors here in how we can increase inventory of housing, not just ownership housing, but apartment and rentals. We've also been working very closely for the committee's information with HUD and how HUD can help us with lower cost housing, and how HUD can help us with more tax credits to be able to afford construction development of housing. We're working very closely with our own government agencies to see how we can develop lands that we own, maybe through the Chamorro Land Trust or even Ancestral Land Trust, and have a develop affordable housing there where we can bring in developers to help us, and we can provide the infrastructure for them. We're working very closely, again, with also our federal partners to see how we can take advantage of grants and opportunities through financing for lower income houses. It's a big concern for us, especially in light of the increased population we will be having with the military buildup. We've also been working with the military to see how they can increase their inventory in their own bases, so that they wouldn't have to take options out in the civilian community, because that does impact the cost of rental and ownership. Construction is another high cost of labor and homes. So we're working, again, to see how we can bring in more workers to help us with our construction opportunities. Supplies and chain supply is another big cost also.
Thank you, Governor. Just about a minute left. Just a final question. Can you speak on how the University of Guam can serve as a vehicle to further U.S. soft and hard power goals in the Pacific, please?
Yes, the University of Guam is our preeminent learning, high learning institution here in Guam. And since its inception, there has been numerous graduates that they have graduated that went into leadership opportunities like of elected officials, business entrepreneurs, and so forth. And the UOG has been very influential in providing that education opportunity throughout the regions also, as many of our COFA citizens have come to Guam for higher education. And so training, I think, is a very key thing in terms of when we look at soft power. Educating ourselves to the ability that we can improve our lives and our livelihood is so much powerful, and that's the importance, I think, of having our University of Guam within this region.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Gentlemen's time has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentlelady from Wyoming, who is also the subcommittee chair on Indian and Insular Affairs. Ms. Hageman, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. And I am very honored to serve as the chairman of the Subcommittee on Indian and Insular Affairs. And I want everyone to understand that this isn't the only hearing that we have held on the particular issues that we've been addressing today. The issues that we have discussed, the relationship with our territories, as well as the other islands in the entire region, has been at the forefront of our interest throughout the last 8 months as we have been in Congress. We have held several hearings in Washington, D.C., talking about the importance of where you're located, and not only your importance to the security and the geopolitical interests of the United States of America, but to the world at large, because of the risks that we all recognize are posed by China and the Communist Party that runs that country. Minister Odui, since taking office, President Whips has reported publicly on numerous occasions where Chinese ships violate Palau's exclusive economic zones, or EEZ. Some of these violations are Chinese surveying activities. In one recent incident, a Chinese vessel conducted questionable maneuvers over your undersea fiber optic cables. When it comes to the surveying, does Palau have mineral or energy potential off its waters that China may desire to sustain its massive economic and military buildup?
Thank you, Congressman. And yes, you are correct. We believe there are undersea minerals that would be of value economically, and they are surveying the cables, very evident from the tracking that we see and the request that they officially make to enter our waters. But the vessels that we see are not made for research. They're made for other purposes. We also see that they are taking steps to name ridges in our waters, we suspect, for a future claim to take possession of some of our northern waters.
Those are highly concerning developments. And through your role as the finance minister, are you able to detail for the committee the significance of these cables for Palau's commerce and what a Chinese threat to these cables would mean for your country?
The cables are very significant to us. Recently, new infrastructure that has really changed the opportunities that are available to Palau for economic growth. We have sought to take advantage of these opportunities and looking at more opportunities in e-commerce, digital government, and other new industries. This is something that we recently found is something to that we don't want to lose, as we had a disruption in a cable recently, about a week's worth of interruption, and we were unable to restore a full service using satellite backup. So it's very important that we do have that additional cable that is being installed right now, and we hope that that will provide the resiliency that we could rely on to attract further investment to our islands.
Well, that's good to hear. President Whips has also talked about those encroachments as part of a possible retaliation from China for Palau's recognition of Taiwan. Minister Dewey, have you or President Whips identified any other adverse treatment from China based upon your recognition of Taiwan?
I think in my experience and some of the discussions I've had are the subtle influences that they try to exert politically. And that is many of the improvements we're trying to make for our people are being resisted locally, often without a good explanation as to why some of our politicians are not in favor of some of these initiatives, such as minimum wage. And we think that there is a resistance to see improvements that our president is proposing.
Well, and I would note for anyone who's watching, and this is certainly a sentiment I will bring back to my colleagues in Congress as we consider the compact renewals, that when we discuss Chinese political warfare, there are clear-cut examples of China using these tactics to achieve one of its main political goals, which is eliminating Taiwan's diplomatic space. And again, I want to assure the folks who are here and the people who have been so gracious to undergo our questioning and visit with us today about these all-important issues that you're not forgotten that the people in Congress really do recognize the important role that you play and that the citizens out here and the islands play in protecting world peace. And so the messages that we have heard today, I think, are very important. We will all be taking them back with us when we go back to Washington, D.C., but I want you to know that you are being heard loud and clear. Thank you so much. I yield back.
The gentlelady yields back. The chair now recognizes the acting ranking member of the committee, Ms. Ledger Fernandez. You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you once again, Chairman, and thank you once again, our panel of witnesses, as well as all of those who are tuned in and all of those who have joined us today to listen and to participate in this hearing. Something that I've been hearing last couple of days that we've been in the area is that it is the role of the United States and it's the role of the leadership of the islands with whom we are meeting and traveling through today to protect not just the bases, right? That would be the wrong approach, but it must also be to protect the places, to protect the people, to protect the reefs and the culture. And that this need of participating with the United States and being part of I'm a Latina, and so we love it when familia just gets really big, right? You can always incorporate more and more into that. And what you need to do is provide both the protection of those you love, but also the security of those you love. I want to touch on the issues around the comments with regards to protecting the reefs, the air, the land, and the culture. Because I know that there are amazing things that have been done. We'll visit Palau and see how they have protected your reefs. And we can't take our own sunscreen. We've got to use yours, which I think is a great idea. But also we heard yesterday about the seahorses that are your representative used to play with in the oceans off of this island and how some of them sort of are no longer there. Could you talk a little bit more about the importance of protecting the beauty that nature has provided us, even while we are developing both commercial development as well as military development, and how that is working, and what should we be doing differently? What advice would you give Congress and this administration to do differently? Maybe I'll start with you, Honorable Uji, see if Governor Guerrero wants to add to that as well, since we are here. Honorable.
Thank you for the chance to talk about our environment. We believe we work very closely with our environment, protecting the source of life for us. It's the small resource, and we can't afford to lose it. It's something that over thousands of years, Palauans culturally have developed a system for. So we continue to use those systems to protect the reefs, which is so important for inshore fisheries and livelihoods of people, without which they would suffer absolute poverty. So it's important for us to continue to look at our resource as something that we need to preserve. It is also a great source of our economy. We have restricted harvesting of certain resources in order to highlight those as economic resources for tourism rather than to harvest one fish. That one fish can bring in millions of dollars in tourist visits to the country. So we have taken this approach in integrating environmental protection and care into national policy.
Thank you. And Governor?
You know, I certainly agree that as an island, we have very limited resources, and the wealth of our people is in our culture, our land, our people, in protecting the environment and so forth. Our reefs also are barriers. They are defense against tsunamis and storms and so forth. And so we need to even be extra careful about protecting our reefs because it's actually the security of our lives. And also marine life is very rich. and can be used for sustaining of livelihood and so forth. It's very crucial. I think your policies with, for example, the NEPA regulations have been so very influential, I think, in adhering and having federal projects and the military adhere to those regulations. And it's in for the influence of protecting our resources, our culture, and so forth. So that's what I think.
Yeah, thank you for pointing out. That was good to understand that in this instance here, the NEPA processes have been useful. As I close, I just do want to recognize, and you know, we heard testimony with regards to the impact from nuclear testing. I come from a state where we exploded the very first bomb. And a nuclear bomb. And when you go to see Oppenheimer, I think it's one of those things we need to recognize that there was also fallout and downwinders, and those who mined the uranium. And so for that, do know that I will continue to raise those issues, because it is only fair that those who have sacrificed for our national security also receive recognition and compensation in for it as well. So thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and I yield back.
The gentlelady yields back. I now recognize myself for 5 minutes of questioning. And again, thank you to the witnesses. And a theme that I've heard today is a sense of pride in this area, love for this culture, love for the nature and the beauty of what surrounds you. And also, I grew up a fisherman, and how can you come to the islands and not talk about fishing? It's already been discussed some. Wish I had more time to spend here and maybe partake in some of that. But thinking about fishing, and Mr. Yudue, you brought this up a little bit about how the Chinese don't really respect fishing conservation and how they've abused that. But also, I know that as a fisherman, if I want to catch a fish, the thing I want to do is put a very enticing bait on that hook. And I want to get it in front of that fish, and I want to make it irresistible. But unbeknownst to the fish, there's always a hook. There's always a hook that's going to take them out of the water and probably to their demise if I take them home and have them for dinner with my family. But I see the Chinese Communist Party on a fishing expedition. I see them dangling bait out to people saying, here's something you must have. And we see what that means. You talked about the hotels, how they booked hotels and then they canceled them and said, well, if you will agree with us, then we will ensure you have tourists coming back. These economic incentives that they provide through their Belt and Road Initiative often seem very appealing, but there's always a hook. And I want to give all the panel an opportunity to talk about how we convey the message to the public that there is a hook, that these aren't just goodwill gestures from the Chinese Communist Party. And also, what does it look like to have a real partnership, both economic and strategic partnership, and what message can we take back as members of Congress to develop that partnership from our end? And Governor Guerrero, I'll start with you, and we'll just go down the line.
I think the message that you should take back is those Chinese threats are very real here to our island. And how you convey that could be through the stories that we have told. And I think it's very important also that we continue the strong relationship with our federal partners, our U.S. partners, and in that way, encourage more support this way towards workforce development, education, and so forth, because that's how we're going to be secure and defensive in this part of the world.
Thank you. Governor Palacios.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, we see it on a daily basis. We see those hooks and those baits being dangled every day. As I've stated, you know, a lot of our economies are driven by Chinese investments. How do we address that? I think the federal agencies need to become more involved, not just in regulations, but become more involved in the development, the economic developments of our island countries, not just in Guam, not just in the Northern Marianas and Micronesia, but across the Pacific. many times we have policies that were put on us, but no guidance. We really need to ask our federal agencies to provide those guidance and the overall overarching policies of our federal government, including those policies that were set into statute by Congress. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Udue.
Thank you, Chairman Westerman, and I want to thank many of your members of your committee for all the support that you've provided us in the process of negotiations, part of it resulting in the appointment of Ambassador Yun. I appreciate that support that helped move our negotiations along. Regarding the fishing analogy and the hook, I think our challenge is getting our people to realize that we need to look for long-term sustainability rather than short-term gains, and this is something that I think during our negotiations we were the U.S. was very receptive to, and the agreement reflects that. I think what has helped us is having that relationship with the United States and having standards that determine how we review decisions. I think it's also about looking at sustainability and how diversification can be part of that sustainability and the impact of the Chinese tourism strategy in not just reserving rooms, but buying rooms, even though there were no tourists to occupy those rooms, eliminating the opportunity for our other tourist segments. And we learned diversification is so important to tourism during the economic financial crisis and SARS fears in the region before. We worked very hard to structure our tourism so that it is diversified with many different countries, visitors. And in the course of 2 years, the Chinese were able to push back on that strategy and weaken us further, making it harder for us to recover post-pandemic.
Thank you. Mr. Quintero.
Thank you. I think the unique thing about the crude beer is my country is the only country that have a diplomatic recognition with China. We've had that for the last 30 years. But I want to confirm that irrespective, even if it's 100 years, it's nowhere near in comparison to the value that we give to our relationship with the U.S., not even close. To our people, to our country, U.S. will and always be that relationship number one. And in saying that, I also want to just reaffirm our commitment to security in this region, irrespective of that relationship. We're committed to making sure that we work with the U.S. on everything and everything that has to do with security and defense. That commitment is firm and is really, really strong. On our side, we have our own internal rules of engagement with that relationship. And I think it's fitting that I submit that we do not engage with them on anything and everything that has to do with the security discussions. If it's raised, we drop it completely. We do the same for loans. If it's raised, we drop it completely. These are just parameters that we put in play just to give us some good oversight. So it's been quite, in my view, helpful. But I guess the strongest message that we can convey to that relationship, that side, is perhaps support and passage of the compact. Passage of that, in my view, displayed the true relationship that exists between FSM, the U.S., and of course our brothers and sisters here. That's just my take on it, but the messaging I think is really, really important at the regional level, especially at the regional level. I think whether we like it or not, The compact itself serves as a standard of testament of commitment of U.S. in the region and our commitment to you. I think whether we like it or not, Pacific Island countries also look at a compact as a way to ask themselves, if it works, then the commitment is there. So there's a sense of evaluation that I think they're the way they see us from their perspective. So that's just my take on it. But thank you so much for the invitation to be here.
Thank you. And Mr. Adding, we'll close with your response.
Thank you, Chairman Westerman. Before I respond to your questions, I just want to say thank you for hosting our citizens in your state, providing them with opportunities, jobs, education, health. One of the community, Marshallese community in Arkansas is the biggest Marshallese community in the U.S. And thank you for supporting our citizens. I have no doubt that there are IUU fishing activities in RMI, in our water. And we're trying our best with what we have, the resources that we have, to try to curtail this activity, these kind of activities. And with the partnership from U.S., we appreciate that very much. We have our Sea Patrol divisions that do that does surveying, surveillance of our water, and also we have the Maritime Authority doing the same. We do have fishing two fishing businesses in RMI, licensed businesses, I should say, and we do export tuna, loining tuna, as well as tuna for canning. So that helped our economy. I can provide with more detailed information to you, Mr. Chairman, in writing. I just need to talk to the right person first and then respond to you. Thank you.
Thank you. And again, thank you to our witnesses. The members of the committee may have some additional questions for you, and we will ask you to respond to those in writing. That will conclude our first panel. We're going to take a short recess while we change out for the second panel. And so the committee will stand in recess until call of the chair, and I anticipate that's going to be at 12 o'clock sharp.
Mr. Guerrero is not related to...
If I can ask the members and the witnesses to please come to the dais. We will begin shortly. The committee will come to order. We will now begin our second panel, and I'll introduce our witnesses. For our second panel, we have the Honorable Tina Barnes, Vice Speaker of the Guam Legislature from Hagatna, Guam. Ms. Irene Scambalure, World War II survivor from Telofufu, Guam. Let me remind the witnesses that under committee rules, they must limit their oral statements to 5 minutes, but their entire statement will be included in the hearing record. To begin your testimony, please, I don't think you have a talk button on those microphones, but when you begin, the light will turn green, and when you have 1 minute left, the light will turn yellow, and at the end of 5 minutes, the light will turn red, and I'll ask you to please complete your statement. I'll also allow all witnesses on the panel to testify before member questioning. I now again, thank the witnesses for being here, and I recognize Vice Speaker Barnes for 5 minutes. You're recognized.
Chairman Westerman, committee members, and distinguished Pacific leaders, I'm Tina Munya Barnes, Vice Speaker of the 37th Guam Legislature. As the longest serving member of the legislature and a daughter of Guam, I extend a warm welcome and express gratitude for your visit to understand our challenges firsthand. My testimony today is based on my personal experience from my travels throughout the region. As a former national athlete and now a policymaker for Guam, I've witnessed the rise of China's soft-powered diplomacy in our region, from airports to critical infrastructure to government landmarks and people-to-people exchanges. China has made it a point to make known their presence, open checkbooks, and influence right here in our backyard. I am the granddaughter of Colonel Juan Munya, whom the Guam Army Guard's headquarters is named after. He organized the Guam Militia, a volunteer force of Chamorros who risked their lives to fight alongside the Americans during World War II. My late husband is a United States Air Force veteran who spent his final days fighting for his life in Arizona, navigating bureaucracy that is the Department of Veterans Affairs. My son is an Air Force veteran, and my grandson-in-law is deployed with the Army. While I may not be able to vote for my loved one's commander-in-chief, I understand duty. This same sense of patriotism and the duty is shared by many on Guam. I'm not a defense expert, but I share with you some ideas on how the United States can bolster our capabilities in this region. First and foremost, we need to come to an understanding that while Guam is a territory of the United States, we are home to about 160,000 Americans, both sons and daughters of Guam, who serve our country, as well as your constituents stationed on Guam, protecting democracy and promoting peace. Despite the nearly $600 billion passed by Congress for infrastructure, our power infrastructure remains damaged from Super Typhoon Marwar, causing daily outages where vital defense points, but lack proper resource allocation. Esteemed members, I understand that some of you serve on the committees that have oversight on justice and immigration. I come before you today cognizant of the issues you face at the southern border. Considering our small Pacific community population decline, we lack skilled laborers, and the growing DOD presence competes for a limited workforce. I urge support for more workers, especially for projects outside the fence, to tackle unaffordable housing and other infrastructure challenges. Many of you remember the problems caused by COVID-19 on our supply chains. During this time, I noticed an uptick in loaded cargo planes from China landing on Guam to refuel. During the pandemic, when traditional supply chains were disrupted, Guam's strategic location posed as a solution to the supply chain issues. I passed legislation creating the Transshipment Task Force to study the success of such an industry on Guam. Today, that study has been funded by USEDA and is currently being conducted. And based on my research and conversations with US Commerce, there needs to be some policy changes to make this happen. Imagine a road where China decides to cut off US from their exports. This would leave us and our allies in the Pacific in limbo. Utilizing the deepest port in the West Pacific right here on Guam would not only strengthen the American supply chain, but create American jobs, boosting the American economy. I hope to be able to count on your support to make this a reality. More importantly, especially with the growing challenges in our region, when DOD assets needs critical supplies to maintain force readiness, making Guam a regional hub for transshipment and trade would make for a better equipped military. But this can't be done piecemeal. This would require a collective approach at examining our infrastructure, strategically investing in our island, the needs of the civilian population in Guam, while reaping the added benefits of equipping the best warfighters in the world. Guam is the hub of the Pacific, and one way to demonstrate this is the jurisdiction of Coast Guard Sector Guam, led by Captain Simmons and his predecessor, Captain Chase. I had the opportunity to learn exactly what they do for Guam and the region. The men and women of the Coast Guard pride themselves on being a force for good, and results speak for themselves. Having a jurisdiction of almost 2 million square miles, Sector Guam ensures that all those who sell our waters are responsible maritime partners. As you may know, most of commerce in the Pacific comes through Guam. With their insights and genuine desire to curb illicit shipments, we passed legislation to implement a digital manifest wherein Coast Guard intelligence can begin conducting their assessment on every container coming into Guam, regardless of their final destination in the Pacific. This has been one of the major deterrents for curbing illegal shipments in our homes. Not only does Sector Guam provide a critical source in protecting our maritime port, a vital hub supporting commercial and defense interests in the Pacific, but the impact that the Coast Guard has on the region is something the entire Blue Continent takes to heart. Whether it be preventing boats with immigrants of our enemies from entering Guam and other neighbors illegally, or our countless successful critical search and rescue operations, I urge each and one of you here today to consider furthering their capabilities here in Guam. The robust partnerships that the Coast Guard has brought to the region is evident in the regular successes we see right here. I thank you for your time and look forward for your continued partnership. God bless Guam, God bless our troops, and God bless America. Si Jesus Masi.
Thank you, Ms. Barnes. The chair now recognizes Ms. Scambalia for 5 minutes. Scambalia. Scambaluri.
Yes.
Well, you're recognized for 5 minutes, ma'am.
Good morning, and Hafa Day. Members of Congress, leaders from the Pacific, and dignitaries, thank you for coming to Guam for this important hearing to discuss the concerns our island has regarding the rising tensions with the People's Republic of China. My name is Irene Plok Scambaluri, and I am 92 years old. I am testifying before you. I am testifying before you today as a daughter of a World War II veteran, mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, and World War II survivor. I love my island, and I believe that this is the most beautiful place in the world, not only because of the natural beauty, but also because of what it represents. Guam is the center of American values in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. I am proud to testify before you today in this field hearing to signify the importance our island has in our nation. Almost 80 years ago, I lived through the worst conflict our island has faced, World War II. I was just 10 years old on December 8, 1941. The feast of Guam's patron saint, Santa Maria Kamalin, the Imperial Japanese military began attacking and invading our island. In the early days of the war, my father, John F. Plok, a U.S. Navy pharmacist mate first class, was captured and was a prisoner of war in Japan. I never had a chance to say goodbye, and I feared I would never see him again. War ripped my family apart and took away every aspect of life I had knew up until that point. During the day, my siblings and I forced to attend Japanese school, where learning the Japanese language was mandatory. In the morning, students would face the sun, bow to the emperor, and then exercise. My brother, sister, and I were physically assaulted in school. They would pull my hair, drag me, and hit me because I am an American. When we were not in classes, we were required to work in the field under the hot and scorching sun. We were deprived of food and water for hours. Shortly after Liberation Day, my father returned from Japan. Sorry. I was overcome with emotion to see that he had survived and that our family was reunited. He had suffered immensely, and I hardly recognized him. He brought back with him a black book with the names of American prisoners of war who were imprisoned with him. I have this book today, and I'm proud to have this as a lasting memory of my family. The war was the most difficult and painful period of my life. And this is coming from someone with cancer. While I have told my story many times, I still find these memories agonizing. While I was one of the lucky ones to survive, I nearly lost my family, my home, and the life I knew. History cannot repeat itself. In other words, Guam should never be the focal point of a violent and brutal conflict in the Pacific. Nobody should ever have to endure what I went through. I would not wish that pain and despair of any worst enemy. I cannot let that happen to my grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and the people of this island. Japan attacked us because of our strategic and important location in the Pacific. With control of Guam, Japan could control the Pacific. China sees the importance of Pacific Islands as well. However, we will not let them have control over Guam and the Pacific region. No way. I will forever be thankful to the United States. When they liberated our island 79 years ago, on July 21st, 1944. I was just 13 years old. And I was proud and happy to see service members land on Ashen Beach. To me, their presence signified more than just the end of the Japanese occupation in Guam. It signifies liberty, democracy, and freedom. These American values have been forged in our culture here in Guam, and we are proud to be where America's day begins. The United States needs to take every possible action to ensure that these values remain a part of our lives no matter what. The federal government has supported Guam for as long as I can remember. You cannot give up on us now. If there is ever a time to support the island, it is now. With your commitment to protecting Guam, I can sleep at night knowing my community, family, and friends are protected by the full faith of our armed forces and government. Don Kuluna Sujus Maasi, thank you very much for having me this morning and allowing me to share with you my story and the trust I have in the United States of America. God bless you. God bless you. God bless the United States of America, and God bless Guam.
Thank you, ma'am. The chair.
If you have any questions for me, please refer them to Congressman James Moeller.
And I'll answer anything you want.
He will answer them at a later date in writing, which will be submitted into the record. Thank you ever so much. Yes. God bless you all. Coming from a 92-year-old lady.
Thank you, ma'am. And the chair will now recognize members for questions. I want to first start with the gentleman from Colorado, Mr. Lamborn. You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman,
Mr. Chairman, I found that very touching for both of the witnesses. I appreciate being here. For the sake of time, I will submit my questions for the written record and yield back to the chairman.
Gentleman, back. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from the Northern Marianas, Mr. Sablon. You're recognized.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Saina, she's a small seat. Gracias. Yeah. Come here and share with us the horrible experience of war that you went through. My 92-year-old mom and I had an argument the other day, and I got to call her and apologize. Jeez. But no, thank you for being here. Vice Speaker, I do have just
thank you.
A couple of questions for you. Well, one first, happy birthday. I understand your birthday today. And of course, Guam, my district, and across the nation, we have this, we face similar challenges. What can Congress do to best help Guam? You, in your opinion, I mean, if given an opportunity, what would you ask for?
And thank you, Congressman, and to the panel members here. If I had to answer that right now, I would say a permanent authority to bring the H-2B labor here, a financial partnership with our power, water, and wastewater utilities, and I'd be remiss if I didn't include an expanded and fully staffed veterans clinic, because we here on Guam have, per capita, have the highest enlistment rate, and our veterans are here in the thousands and thousands. And if we could have a fully staffed veterans clinic, that would help us. Congressman.
Thank you, and I yield back, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Vice Speaker.
Gentleman yields back. The chair recognizes the gentlelady from American Samoa, Ms. Radawagan.
I want to welcome and thank the panel for appearing today. Both of your statements have been very touching, and I don't have any questions at this time, but I will submit something later for you to answer for the record.
Thank you.
And Ms. Scambaluri, you are amazing, and thank you very much for your insights, and of course Vice Speaker Barnes, Jesus Maasi to both of you. Thank you. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Gentlelady yields back. The chair recognizes the gentleman from Wisconsin, Mr. Tiffany.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm very surprised, having a mother that's about to turn 92 years old here in the month of September, that Mr. Sablon is arguing with his mother these days.
The gentleman will suspend. The committee will be in recess. The committee will come to order. The gentleman is recognized, Mr. Tiffany.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I love those words that they had on their signs, peace, diplomacy. That's what the United States of America has always stood for. Mm-hmm. And you see it here with the testimony that we're hearing today and the messages that we've been receiving here over the last couple days. We stand with respect with all of you. We don't seek to use underhanded means and things like that to try to gain authority. We've always tried to be above board in the United States of America. We are imperfect, but we've always tried to do it from a position of respect. And that's why we come here today before all of you, is with respect for what you have to say. And that's the message we will take back to the American people.
I just want to ask Ms. Sambaluri, do you have any lessons?
Do you have any lessons for the 21st century that we should remember as a result of your experience from the 20th century?
Yes, excuse me, because sometimes I have a poor hearing when you're 92 years old, you know. You don't expect miracles. Well, can you again, I'm sorry, can you repeat the sentence again, sir?
Do you want to repeat the question to her?
Yes. Oh, what do you want to share
to the people now, you being 92 years old, what do you want to share with them?
What lessons should we remember now in the 21st century?
All I want to share is that for everyone to love each other, take care of your family, be kind, and always support the United States of America, and don't let any other enemy come to be involved in our island. We don't want that to happen, especially China.
I just want to highlight one word that Ms. Sambaluri used in her testimony, and that was the term liberty. It is one of the most beautiful words that we have in the English language. And if you go back to our founding documents, you'll oftentimes see that our founders as often used the term liberty as they used the term freedom. And there really is a distinction because to me, liberty means freedom, but it also means responsibility for your actions. And that's something we've always done in the United States of America. As I said earlier, we're imperfect, but we usually take responsibility for our actions if we are imperfect at any time. And I just want to highlight, based on my question there, that we're deciding right now in the 21st century, and that's why I'm so grateful for all of you standing together and standing with the United States of America, and why we're here with you as Americans, that we stand with you also. That we're deciding right now whether the 21st century is going to be an American century, just like the 20th century was, with our values, or is this going to be a PRC century? And we have no quarrel, as the chairman said earlier, with the Chinese people, but we do have a disagreement with their government. And we are deciding now, as we speak, are we going to hold those values? Are we going to have a strong foreign policy? Are we going to have a strong economy where we become more responsible with our spending at the federal level, which has led to the inflation we have? Are we going to be energy independent here in America? Are we going to continue to have uncontrolled immigration at our borders? I mean, those things are all weakening America, and a weak foreign policy is certainly something we don't want to have. And I can tell you that's why we're here. That's why we're here in Guam today, is to emphasize to you that we believe in a strong America, and we're going to take that message back that you all want to be partners in that as we go forward. So let's make the 21st century also a great century, a great American century that emphasizes peace and prosperity throughout the world, including here in the Blue Pacific. We really look forward to working with all of you, and I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
The gentleman yields back. The chair recognizes the gentlelady from New Mexico, Ms. Sansbury. You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I also want to say thank you to Madam Speaker, and happy birthday, Madam Speaker, as well as to Ms. Gambaleri. Thank you so much for being here and sharing your story once again, also with honoring us with the opportunity to hear and to also honor your experiences and hearing the pain. It's difficult to hear, but we're grateful that you were willing to share your story again in this public forum. And, you know, one of the things I was reflecting on as I was listening to you share your story is the shared history that New Mexicans have with the people of Guam, because New Mexico is a home of many, many veterans who served in World War II, and in particular, over 900 members of the New Mexico National Guard who were captured at Bataan, and 900 of our New Mexicans who were forced into POW camps, and many of whom who never returned. And Congresswoman Ledger Fernandez and I were actually talking about many of our veterans the other day and how many of the people who we grew up with, because of the pain and the horrors that they experienced, never spoke about it ever again. But we know their stories and we know the losses. And so for us as New Mexicans, our history is inextricably tied with the people of Guam and the people who've served in our great military here in the South Pacific. So I wanted to just honor that and share that history as well. I was struck in particular, I wrote down the comment that you made, Ms. Scambaleri, that Guam and our island nations are the center of American values in the center of the Pacific Ocean. And I also noted that you noted that those values are liberty, democracy, and freedom. And I think, like other members on the panel today, you know, that is really why we're here. It's not just to address the strategic and military concerns that we have and economic concerns we have with the PRC, but to really celebrate and uphold our shared values as Americans and as allies in the region. So I want to thank everyone who came out to be a part of this. But I think it's important, you know, we've heard a lot this morning from our various panelists, to really take a moment to talk about what we are seeing as the PRC's interventions and why they're so concerning to us, and the ways in which the PRC is trying to project power in the region and why that undermines our shared values of democracy. The ways in which the PRC is undermining strategic and economic interests in the area, is trying to reshape narratives in the region and even to retell history to align with their own diplomatic and economic interests, and the ways in which this threatens the stability and values of democracy in the region. And we heard on the last panel why it's ingrained, and I think Ms. Scambellari, your story really reflects that that painful history that we know what happens if we let democracy slip away. So, Mr. Chairman, I just want to say one more time, thank you so much for helping to bring the committee and our task force here. This is such important testimony, and thank you again to our witnesses for sharing your stories. Thank you.
Thank you.
I yield back.
Thank you also. Thank you.
The gentlelady yields back. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Guam, Mr. Moreland. You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Happy birthday, and also to your twin sister as
thank
well.
You.
I want to thank you for highlighting the need for the expanded Coast Guard assets in Guam and within the region. So, of course, this is an issue I've been tracking for future legislative and administrative actions. And I believe it's an issue we can work together on moving forward. So could you please elaborate for the committee why this issue is so important for the people of Guam and for the Indo-Pacific region?
I think, Congressman, with the collaboration and support of Uncle Sam to this part of the region, as we look at strength, peace through strength, and as we look at these threats that are coming our way, and knowing that we are America in Asia or Asia in America, I think the collaboration with Uncle Sam, making sure that the peace through strength is embedded and ingrained in here through the protections, through the authorization of bringing resources to us, it is who we are when Uncle Sam owned us or bought us in 1898 from the Spaniards. And it is because of that that we continue to believe in the true liberties of democracy today and the protections of these waters, of our waters, and the protection of our military personnel coming to our islands and making sure that those protections are here. I think that with strength and helping us within this blue continent and protecting our borders is most keen, and I think that's why we need to have Uncle Sam here in this region.
Benefits to both Guamanians and FAS migrants.
I think as Americans, parity should be shared, and what is given with the folks in the national level should be shared here. We are. You talked about one America. You talked about not us versus them. You talked about us as one family. And I think that when benefits are provided to one, they should be provided for all who call America a part of their family.
Thank you. And for my final question, Mrs. Scambellari, thank you for your testimony. And could you please talk a little about the position you think Guam would be in, put in, if we did not have the U.S. military presence that we do now?
I have lived through a conflict in Guam before, and it was the scariest time of my life. I am worried that this will happen again.
if Guam is not given the proper attention by the U.S. military.
Thank you, Mrs. Cambellari. That was well said.
I really appreciate and thank you for sharing with us here today.
Thank you, Congressman.
Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
The gentleman yields back. The chair recognizes the gentlelady from Wyoming. Ms. Hageman, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, and again, it's so wonderful to be here. Earlier this summer, as the chairman of the Subcommittee on Indian and Insular Affairs, I was invited to speak at the ceremony for the 79th anniversary of the liberation of Guam in Washington, D.C., and it was a fabulous ceremony. It was, I'm learning more about your culture. I have really enjoyed getting to know your congressional representative. He has done an excellent job of representing your interests and being your voice back in Washington. And Ms. Scambellari, listening to you talk about what it meant when you saw those soldiers landing on Guam 79 years ago, and you said that this represented for you liberty, democracy, and freedom. And I do think that those are the words that describe what the United States has always aspired to be, not only for all of us who are Americans, but for others around the world, as we have liberated other areas as well, as we have gone through the scourge of things like World War I and World War II. And now we are facing what has been referred to several times today as an existential threat. And we know what that existential threat is. It is the PRC. It's the Chinese Communist Party. And they have made no bones about what their intent is. In fact, they have been in South Africa most recently talking about their efforts to displace really what for so many of us is embodied in those words, the liberty, democracy, and freedom. And all we need to look at is what has happened in Hong Kong over the last couple of years, the response to COVID-19, the reaction to the to that particular situation, and we can see what the future would be if they ascend and we descend. And so, again, that is why we are here, and it's why we have been focusing on this issue for the last several months, pretty much since the beginning of the 118th Congress, as a committee, as the Natural Resource Committee, and then as the subcommittee as well. One of the things that has been of great concern to me is related to the PRC's illegal, unreported, and unregulated fishing, or the IUU, practices in the vicinity of the Pacific Island countries. And Ms. Barnes, just very quickly, I'd like to ask you a couple of questions about the impact that that has had on Guam and will continue to have. These actions show that the PRC not only disrespects the sovereignty of these islands, but it is a significant national and international security threat. How has the PRC's IUU fishing impacted the economy of Guam and the livelihood of your citizens?
When you take away from the livelihoods of the community, you take away the very vital strength for them to survive. That threat is real. And we need the support coming from Uncle Sam. I want to share with you, not too long ago in the 35th Guam Legislature Speaker, I did receive a call from the ambassador of China saying that I should advocate for a One China plan. And I said, way above my pay grade, this is not right. We are Americans, and that we are here to peacefully, and if this is a threat, then I think that you've really asked something way above my pay grade. But in all fairness to that, as you see that coming here, and you see what's happening with what they can do without the support from Uncle Sam, then we will then have what Auntie Irene Scambellari is so afraid to happen to our children, our grandchildren, and our great grandchildren, and that's peace and democracy. So we can't allow that to happen.
Well, then I agree with you, and I can assure you that every one of the people on this panel will be taking that message back to Washington, D.C., describing the interests of Guam and the surrounding islands and why they are so important not only to all of us as American citizens, but again to freedom around the world. Do you have any suggestions on how the United States can increase cooperation and coordination to address these unlawful activities from the PRC?
I think a full collaboration with our brothers and sisters of the Blue Continent is very key and important. I think as we come together as one big Blue Continent and having over 212 million miles, I think we have a big block of people who believe in freedom and democracy. And it starts with bringing all of us together and sharing in the principles and the values and the equipment and the resources that it needs to protect the freedoms that we have today. No, so that pure collaboration is strictly, needed.
I just want to say how inspiring it is to sit here and listen to the folks from Guam describe their patriotism and what they're fighting for and what their vision of the future is. And I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart to be able to participate in this. And with that, I yield back.
The gentlelady yields back. The chair now recognizes the ranking member, Ms. Ledger Fernandez, for 5 minutes.
Thank you so much, Chair. Mrs. Gambeluri, what powerful words you shared with us, what powerful story you shared with us, and the fact that you are sharing this story, which you yourself said hurts every single time you have to say it. That describes the love that you have for your Guam, the love that you have for the United States of America, the love that you have for peace and freedom and liberty. And I thank you so very much for sharing that love with us today. It was beautiful and it touched us.
Thank you. Thank you ever so much. Thank you. God bless you all.
And God bless you as well. God bless you as well. I wanted to really thank you, Madam Vice Speaker and formerly Speaker, for sharing the importance of treating equal as equal, so that if you are an American citizen who resides in Guam, that you will receive the same treatment as an American citizen residing in New Mexico. I think that was very important for us to realize that, especially given the high participation and the patriotism that the people of Guam show in serving. And can you talk a little bit more about the importance of having reliable VA services and medical services here in Guam?
Thank you very much, Congresswoman Fernandez. We are thousands and thousands of miles away, where expertise and specialties of medical need and what have you, mental issues, all that are needed. We are so far away. And with the little resources that we have here, we have to travel and spend so much money. Don't have to go far. I said earlier, my husband had a very rare lung disease and needed a transplant, and the specialty is not here. We have great doctors here, but we do not have that specialty, and we had to pay, and having to go through the bureaucracy of not just the paper pushing, but the literally telling the story over and over and over again. The veterans here will tell you they don't know who else to turn to. We have done nonprofit organizations to help fill out forms, to help get from one agency, federal agency, to another, sometimes to no avail. We need better collaboration. We need a veteran clinic that is fully staffed. We need workers that can help our veteran families here, because we believe in freedom and we believe in protecting who we are as Americans. And yet, a lot of times we feel that when needing the help back, that support is not provided to us.
Right, and I think it is important that when we say the words, thank you for your service, that we must back up those words providing you with the services that you have earned and deserved. Because if we're going to say the words, mean it when you pass legislation, when you pass appropriations to fund the VA at that level. I wanted to ask a little bit, to the extent you might be aware of it, the Biden administration released the first ever strategy for the Pacific Island Partnership. What have you seen, and what do you think is important with regards to that partnership, and how it may work and influence what's happening here?
I think it's very important. In order for it to work, you need to engage with our islands, and inclusive of our island brothers and sisters. I think with the partnership and the plan, in order for it to be successful, it has to be shared across everywhere that's America. And this administration has taken that point, I think, that we need, the awareness needs to come out. I mean, the programs needs to be here. But more importantly, we need to be able to be to acquire and to be able to be included in everything that is being given through that plan should be shared also with us here in this region.
Okay, thank you so very much. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back. I thank both of you for your testimony and for making real for us in our hearts and in our minds of what you're facing here in Guam.
Thank you.
Gentlelady yields back. I recognize myself for questions. And instead of questions, I think I just want to say a great big thank you, Ms. Gambaleri.
Thank you.
I can tell you that getting to come here and hear your testimony in person made the whole trip worthwhile. And it made running for Congress and serving and doing the job that we do worthwhile, just to have that reminder of how precious freedom is, how we should never, ever forget. I had a chance to look briefly at the book that your father wrote those names in, and I thought how he thought we can never forget these people that made sacrifices, and the freedom that we have was bought with blood and sacrifice. And thank you so much for reminding us of that today and what's at stake.
I am thankful that I am an American.
And Ms.
Yes.
And Ms. Barnes, thank you for your service and for the same passion that we see from both of you. A passion for what we have and where we've come from, and a passion for where we're going. And as I think about December the 7th, 1941, and December the 8th, 1941, I often think not about those days, but maybe 10 years before that. And if those members of Congress that were serving in the 1930s could go back, what would they have done different that could have possibly have avoided what we saw through the Second World War? And I think that's something that we, as leaders, we have to ask ourselves today, is what can we do to maybe prevent another atrocity like happened back then? And, you know, personally, I think that we do see peace through strength, that we have to project strength and resolve. And Ms. Barnes, it's up to you and me and the others at this table now to make those decisions. What do you think we can do as Guam, as Americans, as Congress, to strengthen our position here, to show that resolve, and to hopefully avoid something like we've had to experience in the past? What are the main things that you're looking for from Congress where you want to partner with us to make that happen?
I think presence is key. Presence is key. Resources is key. Collaboration is key. And most importantly, making sure that what America gets, Guam and the islands of the Blue Continent get.
Thank you. And with that, it will conclude our testimony and our questions. The members of the committee may have some additional questions for the witnesses. and we will ask you to respond to those in writing. Under Committee Rule 3, members of the committee must submit questions to the committee clerk by 5 p.m. on Tuesday, August 29th, 2023. The hearing record will be held open for 10 business days for these responses. Again, thank you to our witnesses. If there's no further business, without objection, the committee stands adjourned.
Thank you.